So last week, we talked about what it meant to hang our hearts upon God, knowing that there was room in God's heart for ours. And so we come this week to a continuation of that gospel passage and that reassurance that God will be with us. This is Jesus and his last talk with his disciples before his passion and before his death. In last week's passage, Jesus had that famous claim, "I am the way and the truth and the life." And this past week in Bible study, we were looking at what it means and to know truth and how we find truth and that very rough and confusing friction that can come when we all do our best to discern God's truth and all come up with very different answers as to what that is and how we move through that and go through that. And so I just lift that up because Pastor Kate up here loves it when everything dovetails together like this, and so I have all these conversations in my head and come to my sermon research for this week and find some answers. I love it when God does that. And so wanted to add a further thought to that from our gospel passage and something that I didn't see before. Barry, would you bring up the first slide from John chapter 14? So here is Jesus talking with us and promising that even though he's not going to be here to teach us and to show us what truth is and how to live and how to apply that to our lives, that he will send us the advocate, the Spirit of Truth. But what I never saw before, guys, was the first if you love me, you will keep my commandments. That Spirit of Truth comes when we love Christ, as is shown by keeping Christ's commandments, which are confirmands. You want to throw it out for the congregation, the two greatest commandments? Woo! Somebody's ready for baptism. Bam! So love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. So love of God, love of others, and love of self. I love that that forms the shape of the cross, right? And how we keep ourselves centered and who we are and how we live. What if we understand that we will not be able to discern truth unless we are centered and rooted in love? There is a whole bunch of conflict in our world right now, and as a United Methodist, we are less than 2 weeks away from our annual conference, in which there is already great anxiety about the conflict that the United Methodist Church is going through right now and discerning our inclusion or not of same-gender loving people. There is great conflict in our nation right now and discerning a faithful way forward. If we can be able to be a witness and root ourselves in love and start in the common foundation there, then I just might think we just might have hope of being able to arrive at a common truth that will unite us and carry us forward. But at the very least, and probably what's even more important than arriving at a common truth, we model how we encounter difference and how we encounter conflict and how we carry through and look at that and come to that. And Paul gives us that perfect example in our lectionary text from Acts. How many people here have had a really rough experience of evangelism in which it's the Bible-thumping kind and we are wrung out with what we've done wrong and judged and how dare we and put in our place because there are other people who know way better what a good Christian looks like and we are absolutely not hitting the mark? Yeah. How much does that feel like it's coming from a place of love and wanting to share hope and good news and peace? Because I gotta say, for me and my experience, not so much. And for me and my upbringing, and especially I'm thinking about my time in college and I'm part of this group, that would go out and knock on doors and tell people how they were sinning, and then come back, but we would still pray for all those people who were sinning. But we would never once interact with them because they might lead us down the path to hell. That is a very fear-based faith. And if our faith is so weak that we can't even interact with anyone who agrees differently than we are, then in my opinion, that really sells Christ short. And the truth and the love that we carry in the way that we have chosen and what we follow. And here, Paul models something very different. It's this middle way, as any good Methodist loves a good middle way. He comes to the Athenians, and it's a little bit lost on us today, but his intro, he is lining up Athenian culture in every single way possible in terms of the religious pursuit and practice and intentionality in the culture at that time. And so he's honoring that. He's starting from that point, which means he's taken time to listen. He's looked around, and although he's really ticked off about all the idols he sees, he still takes time to read the inscriptions for the idol. And that's how he finds the inscription to an unknown God, because he's taken time to listen. He's taken time to be present. He's taken time to build relationship. And then from that point, he finds an opening, where how he can connect with the Athenians, honor who they are, love what they value, and take them a step farther. And this is where sometimes the liberal end, if we want to, you know, put categorizations on things, tends to get lost and left behind, right? Because we are so afraid of naming our truth that then we just kind of wishy-washy it away to, there's one God for, and it doesn't matter how you pursue, just pursue God, and that'll be good. Paul still takes a really, really strong, really risky naming in this passage, because he says that all of the gods that these Athenians are worshiping are subject and under the authority of this unknown God, and begins to proclaim God and Jesus Christ. So he both is very strong and very clear in his truth, but here is also room in that truth for others and for a way to connect in love and from relationship to then build and go somewhere together. And I think this is an incredibly powerful witness and call for how we live our truth, both in that we are continually discerning God's truth, because we serve an infinite God and we are finite creatures, and friends, we are never going to have the corner of the market, ever. There is always something that we are going to need to be learning and in process of understanding more fully. And so if we can do that with humility, understanding that whoever we meet, no matter who they are or what they believe, they carry a truth that we can learn from and that can strengthen what we see, or encountering their truth, further refine how we hold our truth and are able to articulate it. This is what we talk about in terms of iron sharpening iron. And when we don't approach this in love, when we don't see in another a truth to learn from, we lose that. And our truth and our life suffers for it. So the gospel call here is to see God's truth. And the gospel call is like Alexa came up to me in her discernment last Sunday in listening to Krista Tippett and talking with Glenn Beck, because, you know, God works in lots of ways. And saying, what would it look like if when we're in conversation with each other, we listen as if we believe the other person likes us, and we speak as if we believe we like the other person, so that we build margin into every conversation, so that we don't immediately trigger and go into defense mode, but that there's space for relationality, for love. Even if it's not there, God can put it there for us if we pray and we ask God. Amen? And so God and the Spirit of truth can intervene if we base ourselves in love and open ourselves up to that Spirit moving in our conversations and in our relationships. And so that is my prayer for us, that we get together in this group at the, how did you say it, Rob? Oh, Rob, I lost him. The Areopagus, I'm sorry, anybody better at Greek than I am? All right, but, you know, when we're gathering there and we're all coming together to learn, I think it's a fascinating thing that as you read through the book of Acts, most of the evangelism happens in response to curiosity and questions that are asked. Why are you doing that? Tell me about that. This new belief you say, we don't understand it. Speak to us, which if you read just a few verses before is what happened here. May we live in such a way that we inspire curiosity in others. And may we know our truth in such a way that when we are asked why, we can respond and share that truth and confidence that the Spirit of truth, the Advocate, gives to us. So may we be followers of the way, the truth, and the life. And we have a great and exciting opportunity as one of our own claims that way and that truth and that life for his life and commits himself to us and to God. And so I encourage you to come and to gather here as we celebrate. There is no bigger deal in the church life than baptism, and it's Suje. So we've got to come and celebrate and be a part of this beautiful beginning and unfolding. And may the power of his conviction and his choice of this truth inspire our own journey and continue furthering our own faith growth. Amen.